Very good morning to all of you. Thank you very much for joining us this morning for the Digital Art Fair Inspire series. Today we are very happy to be discussing, I would say, the very significant and meaningful subject, and that is photography. The title of our dialogue is Photographic Manipulation and the Post-Digital Repertoire. Please do not be scared by the title. It's a very sophisticated subject, but at the same time, I think what we're essentially talking about is how we see photography today, and especially photography as an art form, as a way of expression, and also in our creation, in the, for example, for collectors or institutions. And for museums, etc., what does photography mean today, and where are we going from here? A little recap. As we know, with photography, a lot of people, if you read the books, will tell you that photography was invented around, I would say, the mid-19th century. And for the first 100 years or so, I think most of people would agree that photography is essentially a scientific experiment or endeavor. If you're in London, if you want to know more about the 19th century photography, chances are you won't probably see a lot at our favorite places like Tate, Modern, or V&A. But if you go to the Natural Science Museum, you see a lot of material on the early photography. And then we fast forward to 100 years later, then what we see is the emergence of the small 35 millimeter camera. And I think, you know, ever since that invention, the world has never been the same. And the way that we looked at the world has also changed. It allowed people, we call them professional photographers, and you know, this so-called profession only emerged like 100 years ago, and they can travel around the world with their cameras, and they can show us what the world is like. And later on, we do have these photographers actually creating and coming up with all sorts of photography as we know now: portraits, landscape, space photography, sports photography, photojournalism, you name it. But then, And conceptual. And photography actually played a very important role in many of the major art movement, I think, since the 1920s. And no one would even say now that, you know, photography, or no one would ever dispute that photography itself is an art form, unlike 100 or more than 100 years ago. And then we see surrealism and photography, and we see that, you know, after the war, photography played a major role, for example, in photojournalism, especially, I think, you know, a lot of the artists, they incorporate photography in their creation. But then we fast forward again, when it comes to the 1990s, or in the last 20, 30 years, we see the digital age arrive. Okay, and we see major changes to photography. Before, getting a camera was a luxury. It's only available to the elites. I remember seeing one of the ads of a major camera brand saying in 1950s that, well, you need to pay like, you know, 6 months of your salaries to get a camera. And then now, everyone with a smartphone is a photographer. And no one, well, very few people talk about dark rooms. Now we use light rooms, and then we can do all the editing, sharing, you know, on social media. And we're seeing hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of photos shared by people in different countries around the world every day, every second. So photography, what does it mean for us now, especially today? You know, we are very happy to be joined by a very international and distinguished panels. And let me just briefly introduce each of them now. And then, you know, when they come to their presentation, I will tell you a bit more about, you know, their career and their accomplishment. Starting, may I have that screen again just now? Thank you. Earlier on, we have Mr. Yes, on my right, Mr. Arturo Delgado, who is the founder and director of Almanaque Fotografica in Mexico City. Then we have Mr. Calin Man, the curator of Art Museum Arad and the coordinator of Cinema Icon Group in Romania. And then, of course, we have our own Stanley Wong, another mountain man who is an important visual artist and communicator. So we will invite each of them to tell us a bit more about, you know, what they see photography as an art form or as a way for artists to express their, you know, feelings and creations, and also, you know, from their different perspective as an artist and also a curator, coordinator, and also as a gallerist in Mr. Delgado. So may I now invite Mr. Calin Man to join us on screen. Mr. Calin Man is the curator of Art Museum Arad, Romania. He is also the coordinator of Cinema Icon, a multimedia atelier founded in 1970, where a new generation of artists began producing mixed media and video installation work. During the experimental film phase from 1970 to 1989, 62 experimental films and 62 documentaries were produced in response to a showcase of experimental films at the Centre Pompidou and the Cinéma du Musée. From 1994 to 2004, the group was one of the main promoters of digital art in Romania. In 2003, Cinema Icon represented the Romanian pavilion at the Venice Biennale. Since then, Cinema Icon has returned to the production of hybrid works. Welcome, Calin. Hello, Calin.
Hello.
Yes, Calin, my first question to you. Are you in Romania now?
Yes, and it's early morning.
Yes, I was just going to ask you, what time is it now in Romania?
It's about 6 o'clock in the morning. It's too early for me. But
very good morning, and thank you very much for participating and joining us this morning. Yes, yes. May I ask you to maybe share with us the work that you're showing at the Digital Art Fair this year, and also with this particular subject? Could you tell us a bit more about the Romanian experience, please?
Yes, just a second. I try to put the images. Now you can see is the very first still, very first frame from films ever made by Kinema Icon in 1970 by George Sabo, the founder of the group. The group was founded as an experimental film. As we said, we made 62 experimental films, also 62 documentary films. And after the Romanian Revolution in 89, we transfer our energy to produce hybrid works, installations, and especially digital works in the 90s, late 90s and early 2000. Now we produce digital installations and lately even an NFT as a result of our evolution. For instance, this is the image of our NFT, who represent the entire evolution of Kinema Icon since 97. So after the works produced in on 60mm films, Mr. Sabo, as I said, the founder of the group, in the early 90s, for the presentation for Centre Pompidou, a projection of a selection of our films, he made a montage film called Forspan. He took from each film from 62 experimental films. He removed a frame to create this film called Fauchepan, or bande annonce in French. And this film was projected in the was screened at the studio and copied on the VHS. After this process was completed, all movies from the collection got the temporarily lost frames back. For several weeks, Kinema Ikon owned a montage that canceled all 62 films, and the films, once restored, canceled the montage. All that remained was a video copy. That video copy is a film 26 minutes, and in 2005, this video cassette was transferred to a DVD, and then from this DVD transformed in the 60 stills was where these frames were manipulated and reconstructed as the first episode in a serial made by Kinema Ikon. And this image as an installation you have here. And from these frames, we made the NFT presented at your fair. It's a little bit complicated, but as I said, it's too early for me, and I'm a little bit confused. Sorry. This is the projection of our DVD at the Art Museum in Bucharest, Romania. This is the projection of the VHS tape and the installation with the 62 frames from the 62 experimental films. And a still, this is a still from Fauchepan NFT. So this is the presentation of our work for Fauchepan.
Calin, thank you very much for introducing us to the work of Kinema Ikon. Calin, can you tell us a bit more about, I mean, just now I mentioned about the Romanian experience, especially in the last 30 years. Obviously, we know about the 1989 revolution and the event. And with, I would say, the changes in the country, especially in the development of photography and experimental photography and experimental works. How do you see photography playing this role in this revolution or the experiment you talk about, other than the 62 experimental films and the 62 documentaries? Can you tell us about a bit how you see the trend in the last 30 years and going forward, please?
Well, 38 years ago, I became a photographer of the museum, Art Museum from Arad. So I started photography on 35 millimeters film. And during the time I transfer on a digital camera, but in that period, it was, I think, very interesting to make photography on film. Also, I made an exhibition in the 80s in plein air. which was forbidden in a communist country to exhibit art in public spaces without an acceptance from the Communist Party. So I and my colleagues, we participated in the so-called revolution. But I, for instance, at that event, I was afraid to use camera because we don't know if our revolution wins. So if we lose, the films and the images could be used by the party against the people who were in the streets. So I only made a few images, irrelevant images in that moment. Only after the revolution, our group, Kinema Ikon, published a magazine called The Conversation. In Romanian, it's Conversația. And we try as artists to change the mentalities, and generally we try to change the world, as we said. But we are able only to do, in fact, art. And after 4 years of social involvement and kind of political involvement in changing Romania, we transfer our energies in another art magazine called Intermedia. And from that moment, from 94, we started to work again on experimental art, experimental films, this time on video, and late 90s we have our first digital camera. Also, we made interactive digital art on CD-ROMs and web-based art. And so we exhibit our works in Venice at Venice Biennale in Romanian Pavilion. Kinema Ikon, I curated a work made by Kinema Ikon called alteridem.exe. It was an interactive work, hypermedia installation. And after this presence in Venice, we have an retrospective in Contemporary Art Museum in Bucharest. And also we received a special exhibition room at the Art Museum in Arad. In this exhibition room, we have we made a lot of experiments with installations, video installations, also photography, and interactive art. We use objects connected to the Internet of Things. And also we started 9 years ago a festival, a media art festival. I curate this festival with Ileana Selejan. And each edition is dedicated to a medium or to a concept. For instance, the first edition was dedicated to contemporary photography. And we saw photography as something very fluid. And now our goal is to interconnect different media.
All right. Thank you, Calin, for your sharing. I'll come back to you later. It's your role as a curator, and also, you know, how you curate digital and experimental works. We now turn to our second speaker and our own Mr. Stanley Wong, I think better known to us as Another Mountain Man. Stanley is an important visual artist and communicator. He gained international reputation with his Red, White, and Blue series, which represent the positive spirit of Hong Kong. In 2005, Stanley represented Hong Kong at the 51st Venice Biennale. He established 84,000 communications in 2007, branching out his creative career. Stanley has received numerous prizes, international and local awards in his art for his art, design, photography, and advertising works. His works also have been exhibited and collected by major institutions, including the London V&A Museum and M+ in Hong Kong. Welcome, Stanley, Another Mountain Man.
Hi, morning.
It's very good for you to be here, you know, sharing with us your exhibits at the Digital Art Fair. And also, of course, you know, we look to you to hear more about the Asian, particularly the Hong Kong experience.
Okay, thanks. I do creative commercially and personally. And photography actually is my major tool or medium that I express myself. And in 2 years ago, I was in Heritage Museum doing a sort of retrospective show, concluding my 40 years work. Then, of course, I show my conceptual photography work, maybe it's 5 or 6 series. But yes, all the people know me that, yes, then you do photography in conceptual way. But having said that, not much people knows my day-to-day camera, what I saw, what I took, what was that. So I like to show audience what's the process in my photography encounter or experience. So I spent 2 or 3 years organize my day-to-day snapshot in film, lately some digital, and pull together 8,000 images. And then you can see in the mirror wall, I've also put a little library, 20 books of those so-called topics about people, about time, about space, about Chinese word I very interested. So I just show the process. Then last year, I put these 8,000 images as in the other show as more like a video sequence. Can I see this video? Then within over an hour, then you can see those 20 topics just subconsciously changing and moving forward. Then to me, it's for showing the process at the end, the learning for myself about this organize my archive, my 40 years experience, more like my self-understanding. I know myself better, I think, throughout the process, mm-hmm. what I interest, what I care, what touched me. So I think that is such the manipulation of those process make me learn something. I don't know you would see this as a time tunnel thing, but to me, definitely it's another kind of meaning to sort out those my encounters. So further goes on, then they come to this one work that I exhibit in this fair. Same situation. Those images not supposed to show people, just my encounters. I shot many of these kind of like mountains. Of course, to you it's not exactly mountains, but to me, here and there I see the mountain shape, beautiful scenery. So last year when Design Trust organizing a group show says, oh, can you guys express how you see COVID? Okay, by a piece of work. Then come to my mind is, yes, we're constrained by limitation. We can go, we can travel, we lock down, we can go out. Then people see a lot of restriction. But to me, it's not physical. It's a mindset thing. If your mind is not locked down, your mind is free, then you are free. So I put together this series of photo about the how I see mountains. They are mountains. So can we see a little bit of the video too? At the end, I put hundreds of these mountains as a video sequence in this exhibition. And not this one. Sorry, this will be the other video. And most of the images actually not seen by anyone. Even I didn't really physically revisit them as a purpose. But particularly when it comes to a topic I want to express, then I pull them out and then all put them together, just show how I see the world in different attitude or different way. So this is a Japanese brine. There's some watermarks from the walls. So this is a way how I call, in other ways, kind of manipulation to the content, to the subject. So the last word and another example that I shot a lot of Chinese word or words in the world, in the city. So I put together many Chinese words. See, you can see along the street, shop sign, graffitis, and whatever Chinese word I interested, I just capture them. At the end, I just extract them together, then put together as a video for this show. So the title of this work in Chinese is 香港漢字自言自語. It's in translation is Hong Kong. I see the words in Hong Kong. It's a double meaning. The word is talking, and I'm self talking. So, just expressing my feeling of this very chaotic, uncertain Hong Kong at this moment of time. So this is how another situation. I ran back all the way to all those things I've been encountered. I interest and then to say something that relevant to right now. Thank you.
Thank you, Stanley. Stanley, I think you mentioned something very interesting, and particularly, I think you mentioned about your 40-year career. Obviously, I think it's very impressive with what you have created in the different areas. You also talk about you emphasize the process. Okay, and can I ask you, I mean, if you roughly look at, your career in the last 40 years, I would say that probably the digital age arrived around the middle of this 40 years, since, I would say, perhaps the late 1990s and then right. 2000. Could you tell us, how does this digital age, the arrival, impact the process you mentioned about? And what's different after and before?
Okay, can I answer you that my assumption or prediction, the way I see in the future?
Of course.
As you just mentioned in the beginning, that everyone got the phone, everyone capture images, everyone we see the world, people share images, millions every day. At the same time, I do think we will have a device very, very soon to put in front of your forehead, your glasses, then capture non-stop, continuous image as what you see, right? I also can see the device will implant in your eyeball. That will be automatically see things as physically you're in front of you, nonstop, everything. I do think it will happen. So what are you talking about? That we don't need photography then, because you, what you see is already captured and uploaded, downloaded. That's it, right? But somehow, like your iPhone, will you really how to revisit what you have been done? Even though nonstop you capture, you're able to do so, but what that means, how you utilize them, how you restrict them, become meaningful for yourself, for the artist to look at it. I think that is a big question. Yes. That is kind of how you construct information, no matter that it's more physical or emotional, but still that digital will adding the speed or efficiency of sources of content, but what that means, that's a big question mark.
Yes, Stanley, I think we all look forward to technology, making further advancement, and in terms, especially helping artists like yourself in your creation. Stanley, with your work, I mean, do you find yourself using more and more photography as we understand it, or now photography is, if I may use this analogy, one of the ingredients of your creation that you use to create something bigger or maybe something more, I would say, eye-catching or even something more interactive with the audience? I mean, how would you see that, as part of your journey in design or in creativity?
I'm from advertising background. Mm-hmm. One very, very crucial element in advertising versus the other creative form is time. When you communicate through advertising and promotion, passing a message, time, specific time and moment, when you tell, to tell who, that is very, very sensitive to us. So yes, I live my life. I interest things, I capture, but that's me, it's done already. But how, if necessary, I need to bring something out to communicate, to interact with public, that is about the situation at that time. Mm-hmm. I think I'm certainly already constructing, besides this, the words I express now, definitely I have some other message like to tell in conjunction with the post-COVID, the very uncertain world at this point of time, that's about the timing. Yeah, I will. Certainly, that's my linear, organic forward for myself.
Yeah, we very much look forward to that. And may I now take our audience to time travel to Mexico City, where we are going to meet Mr. Arturo Delgado, who is an attorney with postgraduate studies in art critique. He is the founder and director of Almanaque Fotografica in Mexico City, which is an art agency and gallery specializing in contemporary photography and image-based art. His gallery has participated in Photo London, Photo Basel, and other important arts fairs in Europe and different parts of the world. Like our other two speakers, Arturo is a man of many talents. He is a former diplomat based in Australia, and Arturo also served at the Ministry of Culture in Mexico. In addition, he is an author, an art radio host, and professor at different universities in Mexico City. Welcome, Arturo. Good evening to you.
Good evening from the past in Mexico, and good morning to the future in Hong Kong.
Thank you very much for your participation today. Arturo, I know that you're going to share with us your work at the Digital Art Fair, and also share with us just now. We heard about the European experience, the Asian perspective, and obviously we would love to hear what is happening in Mexico and the American perspective, if you will. Thank you.
Absolutely. Well, I'm going to share a specific body of work by Eugenio Echeverria. He is from Spain. But just before getting into this this body of work, I obviously want to say thank you for all the Girondin effort for making this happening. And I've been just like making some notes after listening to these presentations, because the work that I am going to show, it is not mine. I'm a promoter, I'm a gallerist mostly. I'm the behind the scenes kind of people that is actually looking what is happening and trying to be an intermediate with the audience and with the institutions, with the museums, and in best scenario with the collectors. So what I want to say is that at the Digital Art Fair, I'm going to be, and I'm really honored and proud to be presenting two other different body of works from the one that I am showing and sharing with you today. What is going to be on view, it's a video art by Enrique Méndez de Hoyos. He is from Mexico City. And it's a video film that talks about nature in a post-historical moment. It's a film that it's in the tradition of the video art. It's close in that way to the kind of imagery that Calin was mentioning, and also with this kind of ideas of the stillness that Stanley was also talking about. That's one piece. The other is a pair of GIFs or GIFs. It's always difficult to say which is the right pronunciation, which says something. And it is now considered as a medium per se to present art, obviously around all these ideas of the NFT and the way that we are circulating images now that we are lived drawn in the ocean of images. But what I am going to share with you now, it's actually the new show that we are going to open in mid-November. We are closing an exhibition at the gallery, which is actually, the title is Unique Nature. And what I wanted to say about listening to you is that I guess the spectator, probably we as the promoters or people that are working on the field, we are reflecting on how an image can be unique again, or how an image can be a physical object, or how can we share an image in a way that is going to stand or to be attended, to be paid attention in more than one millisecond of second, which is basically the time that we dedicate to see our Instagram with a very different way to appreciate the scale or the relevancy or the theme, or even just can see an image of the Mona Lisa, then advertisement of soda, then we see publicity, then we see some art, then we see the Kardashians. It's impossible to have like a certain criteria to see, okay, what does this image is telling me? So we can share the images now if you want. This is a body of work by Eugenio Echeverria. So as you can see, this image is a digital image. It is formally could be known as a photograph because it's taken from a body of work that is done in animation, and it's going to be presented in a virtual the headsets, the Oculus headsets that now are the popular or the, well, unpopular, quoting marks, because it's popular for the 0.0001% that can have access to this kind of technology in the world. But it's like the most used. So for this experience, as you can see, is related to the pain, to a personal story, to the desire, to the ideas of the use and the abuse of drugs, legal and illegal, in the queer community. The artist Eugenio is inspired in, obviously, in masters, painters. This is, and then also in the idea of the digital, like the beginning of the video games. Those video games that we could use in the 80s, for instance, and are this kind of intriguing, mysterious characters that are around this experience that it's quite raw, honest, in your face, that talks about personal experiences. I think in photography, as in the rest of art, this last stage of the conceptual art, the commercial art that was very popular in the art fairs around the world, when there was the trend to buy contemporary art, just like people were buying luxurious bags from designers, or this kind of extravagant branded clothing, I guess it's over because of many reasons, because of the end of, because of the restrictions of the globalization, because of the restrictions of the transportation, because of the economical troubles that we are living in the world. So people are now kind of thinking, if they are going to get something, they are going to collect art, or if an institution is going to pay attention in something, it has to be something real again. It has to be, it has to tell a personal story from a very independent point of view, despite the theme. In this case, I know that it's going to be controversial because it's going to be about the use of drugs, because it's going to be about a health problem that is mainly attacking or concerning the queer community around the world, the gay community in particular. And for me, the first thing was how to circulate that beyond the experience with the headsets, because it's only a few people. So that's why we extracted the images, the previous images that are going to be able to you are going to be able to buy it, to collect them as a photography, as a photo, as a limited edition signed and numbered inkjet print, like the traditional digital photography. Other versions are going to be in posters for to attract a younger audience. Even in, even with merchandise, it's going to be a t-shirt or underwear, because the actual experience, we're going to share just a clip, a video, but it's not even in, it's not even the full thing, because you would need to have the headsets. That's, for me, it's a little bit kind of the moment, not the evolution, the transition of the image in terms of art. These resources, like always, the virtual reality has been greatly developed by the brands or the institutions with more money in order to do incredibly attractive presentations. But art obviously has less resources. So if we share the video, you can see a little bit. Imagine that it's going to, this is going to be involving you with the headsets, and it's going to be, you're going to be immersed in this kind of universe, if we can share that. So obviously, Eugenio, the artist, is showing different things. Here is saying in Spanish, these sentences from the Bible, or from the Jew, tradition, or even in other religious traditions, restricting and condemning these practices that are still very controversial and are something to think about. So the spectator is going to be in this kind of fictional universe that it's made of images. Images that are created by the author, by Eugenio Echeverria, one by one in this program that now the artists are becoming artists because they are creating the aesthetics, creating the storyline, the storyboard, the characters, but also all this programming, which is more like a technical thing in order to, instead of just having a brush and paint and put something on the canvas, now we have to create the whole thing. Like it's a mix of a writer, a photographer, a cinema producer, but with very limited resources, because that's, as it has always been the case, the universe of the artist, you know, that we have to create with very limited resources, a great deal of imagination, and then we'll see that characters that I show you at the beginning that are going to be also stills that can be an inkjet in a t-shirt, in a merch. So for me, that's a very interesting way to share how the image is evolving.
Thank you, Arturo. Thank you for showing such intriguing works, you know, with us. And Arturo, I think you mentioned that you know, the controversial side, you know, of the digital art that you share. But I always thought that the most interesting art, as we know it, they're always, you know, controversial, and it opens up our minds to explore and confront issues which are relevant to us. And I think in that sense, I think what you're showing, certainly they are very, very significant. Arturo, with your background, I just want to ask you, you participated in a number of important photo fairs around the world. Just now we mentioned Photo London and Photo Basel, and we are seeing the opening of Parifoto next week. excuse me. Arturo, can you excuse me, share with us, for the new digital art form that we saw just now, I mean, if I remember correctly,
I guess
they are not the mainstream. I mean, they're certainly perhaps only making an entry into the important art fairs around the world. I mean, what do you see? What do you see the collectors, photo collectors around the world? How do you see them starting, or what are they looking for in terms of the digital art that you mentioned? And then how do you convince the major photo fairs in the world that, you know, what you're showing is something that is very important and that is of the future?
Well, I think now a little bit more and more things are getting a little bit more clear, at least for those who are to Almanaque Art Fair in Mexico, which is the largest in Latin America, then Photo London, then On Scene in Amsterdam, and just recently in Amsterdam, it was one of the go. And they have a section which is called Unbound, which is similar to or equivalent to the Unlimited section of Art Basel in Switzerland, in terms that there is a knowledge, there is an acceptance that photography is one thing, image is another thing. They are related, but they are a little bit different. And in most cases, at least in my opinion, the artists that I've been working with tend to present and to conceive themselves more as artists than just photographers. I do work with very relevant artists, like the one I have behind, which is Pablo Ortiz Monasterio, mm-hmm. from Mexico, that he worked in the tradition of the documentary photography, and he's from the 90s. I mean, he's not that old. The tradition of black and white that we all know that is probably what the majority of the people understand when they think about photography. It is interesting that in Mexico, the section of photography, it's in the area of antiques, of the are in visual art. I think, first of all, I don't think there is some that individually, if we put apart the museums or the institutions, the individuals, there's no such a thing as a collector. There are supporters, fans, players, collectors. Some of them are able to buy, to collect something. And what they want is something that talks to themselves. So I think despite the medium or the format, what people is looking for is for personal stories that are saying authentic things. That's what I think.
Okay, Arturo, just a follow-up question before I open to the floor. Arturo, you also mentioned, I think, the as gallerist yourself. And I just wonder, how would you, or how do you see the major museums and institutions around the world, how do they receive, you know, this digital, you know, art, I would say, all the pieces have been, you know, which have been created, some very, very important as we see it, and, you know, with, I would say, a lot of value, and even some would say, even can we apply the term, you know, future classics to them? I don't know. But for museums, I think, you know, with their division, usual division, you just now mentioned there's a difference between photography and images. So how do you convince some of the, I would say, more traditional museums and institutions that they should start looking at digital art, they should start familiarizing themselves with this important art form, and then they should start collecting them and build up a major collection before it's too late?
Well, I think institutions or public museums around the world, they are obviously familiar with the field for more than 30 years because they've been buying collect video, and they be collecting all these experimental medium or formats that register an image. So curators, I mean, people behind the institutions and the museums obviously are enthusiasts. Mm-hmm. I think the problem that are very limited. Around the world, the museums are very limited in terms of budget. In some of cases are absolutely restricted or even banned or prohibited to acquire because of other reasons, because of social reasons, political reasons, economical reasons. So I think that my hope is that these independent institutions, independent collections, independent even enterprises or brands or companies that have the resources and the sensibility to see this is something that is describing the human. This is something, this is the portrait that I got in my family room, but now it's not a of the modified videos that we can see in Romania, or is this video reality that is creating a video game is telling a story. So as long as there are people saying, okay, this is describing us, I think we still have hope that it's going to be in a museum somewhere.
Right. Thank you. I mean, I think we do need important patrons to lead and also support the digital art movement, and then especially with their collection and even donating major collections, you know, to museums, you know, for them to start. We see in the 20th century, for example, what Peggy Guggenheim did, and a lot of major, I would say, patrons, like now we know the Barnes Foundation, the Phillips Foundation, et cetera. And in Japan, just now we were talking with Stanley about, you know, the exciting things in Japan. You know, we see Suntory, we see And all the major corporations, they are actually behind, you know, the art movement in different stages. I would like to invite all of you to send in your questions, you know, for the speakers. And while we're waiting for your questions, can I go back to Calin? Calin, you are a very important curator in that capacity. Do share with us a little bit about, you know, when you curate experimental art. Please share with us, you know, some of the tricks and what you learn in terms of you curating digital art compared to the curating, for example, the more traditional art form or photography in the past. Please, Calin.
Well, in fact, I'm an atypical curator, because I curate only works made by our group, Kinema Ikon. So from the beginning, it means from the early 90s, we made exhibitions in different media. And I try to express the differences of our group. So if in the beginning we made exhibitions with different media, such as objects or even performances, in late 90s we made exhibitions with digital art, with CD-ROM art. It was the beginning of digital art, as you know, CD-ROMs, and then net art. And we transfer our abilities to make the hypermedia installations. And with starting with the media art festival, we have a dialogue with the spaces where we exhibited. For instance, we put the works in atypical spaces, such as a store in a mall, for instance, or we transform a cinema theater in an exhibition space. A kind of white slash black room. And we exhibited in the Natural Science Museum with the exhibits from the Natural Science Museum, where we put our installations and so on.
Calin, thank you. We have received a question, and I'll just read out the questions. It's for everyone. How do the panelists see the rise of NFTs and blockchain, and how is it impacting the way we experience and consume photography and image making? Perhaps I'll ask Stanley to go first for this one.
Yes, finally, I'm in NFT. Although I have a question for so long, and I would say it definitely is a good channel, good platform to share, to communicate, and yet to own in ideal way or in commercial way, because it's the money behind the ownership of the whole game. Having said that, I will look forward the major conceptual artists to willing or rely on this kind of virtual space to express their thinking, their mind, become more sophisticated, more all-rounded, because it's now still one linear kind of dimension. I will predict, actually I have confidence that in the next stage of NFT, that become very substantial, more vibrant entry point to have a more fruitful dialogue. Then now it's more visual excitement, or not all, but mainly it's just more like an experiment, not yet to the hard-hitting kind of things that I can receive of audience. Yeah, I look forward.
Thank you, Stanley. Arturo, just now you show us your work that you are showing at the gallery. Are those works available in NFT?
Well, I have a couple available in NFT, and I have to say that I, like you, I also have my restrictions and my opinions. First of all, because I think NFT is a different thing. Despite, I mean, from photography, from image, and from art, NFT is a way to register. So that's why I guess it's making a little distortion, and it's so something that works in different areas of the world also in a different way. I saw as a gallerist last year in Miami. December, that is going to be 1 year. And as you remember, last year was the boom of the NFT that honestly, in my opinion, I guess it caused a distortion because there was a lot of people more willing to try to understand the technical or the formal way to use the NFT more than the actual work of art. And also, I think there are a lot of people that are not necessarily committed artists. They are using the NFT because it's something that they consider is an interesting investment, or they are even speculating, or they are using it for a different purpose than just art. So I guess it's a different thing. Eventually, it's going to be something more sophisticated in terms of arts. I've been participating in several experiments and several ideas around that. I guess we are getting to the stage that in a shorter time, we're going to see something more accurate or at least more clear of how artists can use the NFT as a way to circulate or to share their work. Actually, the works that I am sharing with you at the Digital Art Fair are obviously available with NFT. I have a couple in the gallery. The gallery in the current show, that please go to the website, is Almanaque Fotografica. As I told you, the show is called Unique Nature. So I have very antique ways to produce an image, like the transfer of pigments with each is almost 200 years ago, but in a contemporary way. And I am also showing an NFT. So it's something that it's evolving, but I guess art is like that, it's experimentation. So we have to experiment. The more that the artists experiment in the field, the more that we're going to see something relevant. But that is something that I am still waiting to see.
Thank you, Arturo. Calin, NFT and blockchain, your thoughts?
Yes, for the first time, I think NFT give us the idea of an original. It was very interesting in the late 90s and at the beginning of 2000 when we made our first digital artworks. The most interesting thing was that we don't have an original in digital art. Also, in digital art, we have this kind of idea that the art, the digital artwork is like butter, it expires. It's not forever. Because the support, the computer, the software exports in expires in time. So for the first time, NFT give us the idea that somehow we have a kind of an original, and with that copy, we could use. In a way to sell the artwork, for instance, when Centre Pompidou bought a CD-ROM I made, the price was the price of a copy. It wasn't an original. That's why it was very interesting for me. And so in terms of expiration time of an artwork, at Kinema Ikon, we produce an hard disk called Survival Key from Kinema Ikon, which in 2 years expires. On that CD-ROM, on that hard disk, we have the entire work of Kinema Ikon. So from time to time, we transfer our entire work on a new support. So in this case, NFT and the blockchain maybe will give us the idea that digital art could survive.
Calin, I think you have just answered part of this, the second question that we received, which is, I have to read it out, the blockchain is also a useful tool to capture values that is immutable. Is it a good tool to preserve culture? So we have heard the perspective shared by Calin. I don't know whether the other two speakers would like to give us further insights into blockchain, or whether you see actually blockchain, Stanley, playing a more and more important role in your work going forward.
I think I want to use repeating one word just mentioned that as another speaker, is that relevancy. I think that is very important to judge or to measure the values in all aspects. The relevancy of the contents in conjunction with time in future, that you will see the art or the message, the content will be timeless in terms of relevancy. I think that's the way I judge, not the device how it maintain.
Yes, thank you. I think our time is almost up. I would use the last 2-3 questions to ask one minutes to ask one last question. Stanley looked at his crystal ball just now and told us, you know, how he sees, for example, in the future we could have possible devices which help us capture the really precious, important, or decisive moments in our lives. If I ask all the speakers to look at your crystal balls and look at this subject that we discussed today, last-minute thoughts from all of you, maybe 1 minute. You know, could you share with us how do you see this digital revolution and all the new art form coming out? How do you see this developing in the future? Maybe I'll start with Arturo this time, and then Stanley, and then Calin. Arturo, please.
Well, first of all, I think the revolution just started, and we are just seeing now because we are in different countries around the world talking about this thing with enthusiasm, and the especially the younger spectators that are willing to see everything online from the cinema, but also from the food that they are going to eat, and from the education, and from the everything. Obviously is going to be evolving. All these ideas of the and the demands to the museums that they have to be immersive and that they have to be aware of the way that we use the time and the way that we use that how we share the what we are doing. I guess it's going to be crazy, fun, powerful, and it's the responsibility of ours, of people like us, to choose these things that we consider are describing it better, and to put them in words, and to tell the stories, and to make people understand why this is something that could be related to art, to culture, and to the human heritage.
Thank you, Turo. Stanley?
We are talking about image making, right? In the other world, about painting, then we have an AI device. One is called Mid Journey. Then you command some keywords, then your creation of painting in mind will be realized that you own this painting as an artist. Then I think, yeah, crazy. To me, it's a very crazy different values. But at the same time, it's good to let us think values as a human, what we see things in truth, in real or surreal, untrue. We are born to be in this point of time in the course role. Sure that we have a lot of debate, a lot of yes and no argument on things, not necessarily on artwork. I think that the art production will lead into our way of seeing values. I think that I want to observe and be part of it.
Thank you, Stanley. Calin, you have the last word on where we go from here.
Well, the future is now. For instance, right now we work on to create a sort of monster, a chimera, made from 9 modules, 9 installations, digital installations. So each installation interacts with the other, and so in time, the artist will be the spectator of his own work.
Thank you, Calin. On that very creative note, I wish to thank all of you for participating in this very intriguing subject today. Arturo, Calin, Stanley, we are so blessed to have your insights and advice and also the prediction as we proceed into I would say, a whole new world for the digital art. And I also like to take this opportunity to thank all of the participants here today, either physically present or online. And may also congratulate the Digital Art Fair and also, Joyce and her team, Professor Ng, for organizing this very meaningful conference for us to have this dialogue. So thank you very much again, and look forward to seeing you and, continue exploring and also experimenting. Happy shooting. Thank you.